Good morning. Happy to see so many of you attend on this, well, not so easy subject. At least the end part is a bit more complicated. Say goodbye to Varum Dai. My name is Duke Spear. I'm from Utah. Tips for presentation by Duke, and I think I took some wrong notes. Well, I'm Marco, Joomla enthusiast, but yeah, not that really important. Anything in this talk is the thing that you will share on the JAB17 Ethereum group, my name. I think this is the thing that you will want to remember. That's where you will find the slides. That's, I have to put them up there, and there's a elaborate explanation of the very last part of this presentation. So, what will we be covering? So first of all, the two major alternatives. Saying goodbye to var dump die implies that var dumping something while debugging your code is one alternative. Using the debugger will be the other. We'll talk a bit about what's in it for you, the rule set and the debugging. And we'll cover the setup, how and what do you need to do to get this setup on your system. Alternatives, choice is difficult. What will we use? I tried to use an analogy that should be known to many Joomlers here. Although it's really practical. Can we dim the lights because it's even I can't see what's up front here. On the left side we have the left twix var dump factory. What's its advantages? Well, it's very easy. There's no setup required. You just go, edit your code, and wait for the results. Who has been using var dump in debugging? So that's easy. But what would you think? What's the disadvantages? Anybody? Any disadvantages?
To use it on the side.
Yeah. Yes. Implicitly.
That is the one for the user.
Sorry?
Yeah, in production, fixing a lag, it's not the support for the user.
Yes. I summarize it for me.
So
what I'm not happy about with var dumping and dying is that you modify the code. Be it your test code, be it your production code, there's some form of programming required if you want to build more difficult stuff. And for me also, very often, where did the output go? Because it should be somewhere, but I don't see it. Who has been facing the problem that some var dump was left behind? Well, raise your hand. There's nothing nothing to be afraid of. But yeah, that's what really got me into thinking, okay, there must be a better solution to this. So on the right hand side, we have the right twix factory, the XDebug one. So who can name me some advantages of using a debugger? Who has used a debugger in general? Oh, that's quite a lot, so very happy to see that. Because, as a matter of fact, this talk is dedicated to someone who's not here, who is typically dressed in red or orange, has fluffy hair, and has t-shirts with text like, I'm an opinionated idiot. Can you guess?
So you, Bobby?
No. It's a Brit. Initials
George.
George James Wilson, yes. Well, story is he used to work at my company for several years, and he used to be, and I think he still is, an avid fan of var dumping and dying. But it left us with some challenges at times, and I tried to get it to structurally move over for 2 years, but being having that t-shirt, I'm an opinionated idiot, never got there. So this would have been my final attempt. I guess he said he would come, but alas, he's not here. But then, okay, what's the advantages of debugging? Why would you want to use a debugger in more general terms?
You have context, you don't die.
You can switch the variable and go on. Yeah. Okay, I think there's a few more reasons. So obviously you can use locate your bugs. But I think understanding the code, to me the debugger is the ultimate documentation tool. Notwithstanding the fact, for example, that FOF3 is well documented, there's a lot documented, but when you go into the details, you will notice that you still miss a lot of stuff, at least I do. Using a debugger, I can understand much better what's going on and how to use that code to see what the flow is, look at variables, inspect them, modify them, come back to that. We can review the code, see if the flow makes sense, understand it. And last but not least, you could profile your code, see which parts are executing slowly, which are faster, where you need to optimize. I'm not covering that in this session though, so sorry if you're waiting for that. Well, obviously, anything with an advantage has disadvantages. And for the debugger, to me, that is, well, I have to do something next on the server. I have to get to my server. If you're on your local machine, that's easy, but yeah, we'll cover that later. But getting to your server, if it's in production, for example, you need to access that. And you always need an in-sync local copy of the source files. Otherwise, you can't see what you're doing. So, what's the tool set? What can you use to debug? Well, as with any problem, there's more solutions to it. I'll be focusing on a combination of PHP Storm, XDebug, and using a secure shell, SSH. With these three tools that are available on any platform, you can just do about anything you want. PHP Storm is not mandatory, but that's what I'll be using in the explanations. But you would find similar setups in NetBeans, Eclipse, or just about any IDE that supports debugging. So if you're a fan of those, just try to see through the example and say, okay, well, that should be available for me in another setup. So the actual debugging, the squatting of the bugs. First, let's talk about breakpoints. Who doesn't understand the concept of a breakpoint? There's no shame in not knowing something. Otherwise, I can just skip the entire presentation if that's. No, I would say a breakpoint is the soft equivalent of your die in your Vardan die. It holds the execution at a certain point, where with the Vardan die, you just outputted something and you can find it, and then it stops and you don't want it to be overwritten by something else. So you hold the execution at any position. In PHP Storm, you just left click next to the line that you want and you see a little red dot appear. That will mean that if it gets there running, it will stop. Now, contrary to using Vardan die, well, not necessarily too Vardan die, you can have multiple breakpoints and then you want to fire them all at once. So you have an option to temporarily disable a breakpoint. You alt click it, turn three, doesn't stop there from that moment. So that's already much more convenient. You're not changing your code, and still you can define what you want to do. But there's more you can do with a breakpoint than just dumping and dying. You have a certain level of control. If you hover over them, and you can see, okay, well, it's in this file, that line. In this case, there's a log expression, we'll come to that. You just simply right-click a breakpoint indicator, and you will see that you have control. Yeah, that's gear for everybody out there. Or at least for the speaker. So, you see that's the line. You see it's not enabled, because you just click it to be green. But it's set to suspend. And there's more options to it. We'll go into more detail there. So if you click on the more options, you'll see the subset that you have here. So you can enable a breakpoint, suspend, condition, or proper dose in a set. And here you see a nice overview of the breakpoints that you have. Now, one of the basic things that you can do, if you want to see, okay, does something happen? Is some part of my code executed? In the far don't die scenario, you print something, or I don't know, log something to a log file. Here we have the equivalent of just logging a message to the console. So you don't need to modify your code to print something. In the most basic instance, you will say, see, okay, the breakpoint is reached at that file, that line number. But you can also have, evaluate a log, I didn't fill it in, but you can add your own text, something like that. If we find things, it will be output to the source file. Again, to me, it's very important. You can do that stuff, see what's happening, but you're not modifying your code. Now, those breakpoints are always met. So you can either hold the execution, log something, but that's always. But that's not the ideal situation you would want. If you're in a loop and you're interested in the last element, loop, it's three levels and it's okay, but if it's like 1,000 levels, not so much. If you want to inspect element 942 or whatever. But that's why they invited conditional breakpoints. You can set that, well, it's hard to read, but set OLI equals 42. You can add any expression that is valid at that point of the execution in the code. So any local variables that are used, any indices, any globals, what have you, that you can construct something. If name is George James Wilson, if whatever, only if that condition is met, it will break. So that's very convenient. If you have control structures that are more difficult and large, that's the way to tackle those. Now there's another way that says, okay, conditional breakpoint with a previous breakpoint. So only if some earlier conditions were met, it passed through some piece of code, which is identified by a breakpoint, then I'll break on this breakpoint. So you can say, go through the entire initialization sequence, do some other stuff, and I say, okay, once I've gone through all that initialization, I'll enable my breakpoints, and if that's somewhere in a library file that's shared by the initialization, you're not troubled by the code halting during the initialization. So, at least a piece we saw, it's convenient, as you can just click on the drop down and you'll get a list of the breakpoints that you previously defined. You can just click one, and then it will hold. Now there's a third beast of things you would want to trigger upon when things go wrong. In also in the Joomla code, we're moving away from local dying, so as to speak, as to using exceptions for error conditions. And whilst that is a very nice way, it can also be a pain to understand, okay, where did I come from? A certain exception is triggered, integer is out of bounds, whatever, something. My SQL is not completing, there's tons of exceptions available, and you can have your own. As soon as the exception is triggered, typically you don't have a clue where that's coming from. But PHP Storm and probably all the debuggers also allow you to set a breakpoint on exceptions. So in the control panel for the breakpoints, you have this PHP exception breakpoints. And if you click on that, you will see you get this add exception breakpoint, and again, you will see the types of exceptions. So for example, in FOF, there's an access forbidden. That's everything with the IDE. As soon as you start to type, it will complete it, and it will help you in figuring out what exception to trigger upon or hold upon. The last one could be that you can choose to have a breakpoint remove once it's hit. That can be used in more complex situations where you use a breakpoint to trigger the starting point of the next one, but then the next iteration you do not want to hold on that, so that could be convenient. Any questions about breakpoints, logging, and stuff, or personal anecdotes to say, okay, this saved my life, or anything? Okay. So we saw how to inspect, and that's similar to the dump and buy and stop there. Fortunately, with a debugger, you have the option to explore, stepping, running through your code line by line. So I will learn how the code is set up, get the flow, or get to the point where it was broken. So, first thing in this PHP Storm, what you can use, and that's on the this is the debugging window you will see, and that's on the left-hand side. So you can show the execution point. And that's this little icon. So if you've been moving around through your code and you want to get back to where the code has stopped at this moment, has frozen, you can use this little icon and it will get you back to this line where your code is being executed. If you're stepping through code, there's typically two scenarios. So this is an assignment which calls a function. Now you might be interested in what's going down here, not necessarily what this layout relevant model fields does. So that's why we have a step over. It means it executes that line. Doesn't care what's inside it, it will implicitly run over, step over. Now, of course, if then if your execution goes up, then you know that you have to get back to that point and then step into that function, where it will mean, okay, I'm on this line, and if I say I step into this, it actually will start to execute this function, and you will end up in that function and can step through it at that time. Now, when you're... I missed some... an image got lost. If you're inside that, imagine that there's the function body of that function you were just stepping into. I'll add it later again, sorry. And you think, okay, this is not it. And you want to return to where you were, then you can step out of that function, and that's this. So it will run through the code at that level and return you back to the level where you step into a certain function. So we have to step over. Did that? This could be an example of the code. So you've got your function, you would step out. But you could also say, okay, if I'm here and I'm not interested in what's going on here, I can just mark my cursor here. It's very difficult to see on this page. And then run until the cursor. So there's a many ways to control the flow of running through your program, and that makes it easy, very easy to inspect. Along the way, you might want to look at variables, stuff. You can evaluate expressions. Okay, now you see this expression, this container platform is CLI command line. You can actually evaluate that, even if you're here. I forgot what that was. You can evaluate it, and it will say, okay, well, that was false. But you can add anything that you want, evaluate any expression, test out stuff, and box your own. That's the evaluate expression. If you're debugging something, and, well, that one function to lay out the relevant model files, fields. Yeah, you've seen that now. You don't want to end up there every time. You can add it to a skip list and say, okay, well, don't listen for events in there, just ignore it for the moment. Not interested. So, next is the flow. So you're you've got your stepping, but you have to start your debugging, you have to stop it, continue. Well, there's some very basic commands for that. Also on the left hand side. So, this would be just run the program. That would mean it would run until the first breakpoint, or until the program ends. Obviously, you might want to stop running. The trick here is that if you don't stop running, XDebug will lock up your web server because it's halted and it's waiting for its next command. So whilst it's running, you can't do anything with it anymore. So you can't go into the administration. So either you terminate it, so you kill it, and then you'll end up with a write stream since the execution of your program stopped mid-program flow. So nothing useful typically comes out. When you're running, you might want to see what's the overview of my breakpoints? That's also on the left hand side. So, what stuff do I have? And you can jump around in your code in that. And this one I find most useful. And also, well, I hate it and I love it. I love it because this one, if you click this, it mutes the breakpoint. So from a certain point on, if I want to gracefully terminate my program, I found something, I want to run it and return to the normal state, I can click this one and it will mute all the breakpoints to come. So after that, when I press the run symbol, that one, it will run through all the code until the end and the page terminates correctly. Now, why do I hate it? Because I can't count the times that I forget to turn this off. And then the next time, I want to think, why is that breakpoint not hit? But sure, that's only me. You wouldn't have that, I guess. Okay, so we've covered the control part where you can start, stop, log, do stuff. We cover the running part, how to run through your code, run to the next breakpoint. But there's one very important thing. It's the inspecting and manipulating part. So on the bottom half of your XDebug, you will actually have two panes on the test variables. Now, since I took this from the index.php, there's not so much there, but that can be a huge list of variables that are available. You can also see here, for example, there's a database query, and you see you can unfold that to actually look into that array in this case, or you can inspect the disk, so 39 elements. That list is unfiltered. Everything that's available there in your piece of code is shown. If you have a bit more complex piece of code, that can become cumbersome. So that's why we have the concept of watches. So we watch the stuff, and that's on the right hand side. So any variable that's here, you can pull over here so that like you have your own custom selections of things that are important to you in that in running that piece of software. So it's the selection of here that you can use. Now, apart from inspecting those, you can also change it. So you could say that this override limits was set to false at some point, but and you've stepped through the assignment, and then you want to evaluate what happens if that override thing was set to true. Well, actually, you can just double click on this and change the value of that variable at that point in time in the program flow, and then when you continue the execution, your application will take your changed value to run the remainder of the code. So that can be very easy to evaluate scenarios. It's like a shortcut of setting up a test case where this actually is true. And well, I'd like to think of, well, maybe lazy is not a good word, but I'd like to spend as little as effort as possible in getting things done. So that can be very useful to change variables and run through your code like that. Now, for the hard die or the die hard, hard and die people, there's of course also something like a command line thingy. It's called a console. So, the equivalent of doing a hard and die of query, which is the here, you just type query. You can omit the hard and die console. The hard and part the console knows what to do with. Now, you might wonder, okay, but did you not just tell me that we can inspect variables? Yes, we can, but if you inspect a variable, it's a very tiny piece of screen estate, and if you have like a very large output, it's very cumbersome to find the stuff that you want. So this query thing is quite long. That's time for me. So that's the query. But if I'm interested in only the SQL stuff, I built my query using the query builder, and I want to know what the real SQL statement is, I could scroll down here. It will be there eventually. But you could also just say query underscore to string, and it will just output that. So any command, any function that you have in your code, you can execute there. And it will run through it, and it will make output stuff that you want. So that's the balance. Obviously, you can also cut and paste this to a text file, search for it, so that's why it makes it more efficient and easy to use that, instead of the inspector windows. The inspector windows are very convenient for just looking at a variable that's single string or number. So we started very late because of technical problems. So, some miscellaneous stuff. It was, I'll try and speed up a bit because it's kind of impatient. It was called, it's a call stack. As soon as you have a breakpoint, it will be listed on top, and actually it will show where it, how it came there. So through which files the calls were made to get to that point of execution. So that could be very helpful when you stop here and you want to say, okay, what happened in the view, or what happened in this on before browsing time, because that might be now the root cause of your problem. So you will go to this file, put a new breakpoint, and run your code again. One of my frustrations with all of this is that I have yet to find a way to decently debug any simple Py XML stuff. Allegedly, it should work. I haven't found it to work for me. So if anybody here has it working, I'd be very happy to hear about that. Now the next one you would recognize, because that's one that we spent many an hour on last year in Barcelona. We didn't figure out what it was. I only figured it out a few months ago. And that is at times the debugger will seem to have lost its way. You can break on the first breakpoint, but then if you stack, it will go haywire. All kinds of crazy stuff will happen. And I only found out that, at least my assumption is that somehow the memory gets corrupted, either by doing something silly with a pointer yourself. But the trick will be, in that case, if your debugger acts up really strangely, remove all your breakpoints, restart, and then typically I find everything's okay again. So if you have that behavior where your debugger stops but you can't stack, try this. And if it doesn't work through the GUI, just go into the XML file of, in this case, PHP Storm. Now the setup, we've gotten to what to do, now we need to know how to do it. So using XDebug as a tool, we have to do something for the browser. So the browser has to tell our IDE that it wants to be debugged. Either you can use bookmarkers for that, that will add some extra parameters to your URL, or you'll have browser extensions like this one I think that's, I don't know, Firefox or Chrome, where you can enable or disable debugging. If you're doing your remote command line in the CLI script on the command line, you could set some of those variables using environment variables. And we'll come to that, but this one, IDE key 9005 in this case, is done very important. If you want to set up XDebug, you can read all about it on xdebug.org.install, but either you use Peckle, or you use Brew on the Mac, you can install it from source, or you just do apt-get install something, and that will install your library on your server or your local host. You could be lucky if you're using a Vagrant image or a Docker image that has it installed. So for example, the Vagrant image from Joomla Tools has it installed, so you don't have to do anything. Or you build your own one based on Joomla Tools or any Docker image and configure it. To configure it correctly, you can feed the outcome of your PHP info in this wizard, xdebug.org/wizard.php, and then it will tell you, okay, you have to set these settings in your php.lini file. Not going into that in detail, you can just run that exercise and then all should be round. If you want to know if you were successful, you just run PHP info again, and you should see an XDebug section. Or you can just look in the Joomla backend. Okay, on to PHP Storm. This is the left-hand part of the more complex image that will come later. But there's three or four parameters that PHP Storm needs to understand to do the actual debugging. So first we have the debug port, annotated here by P. In my case, it's set to 9003. That's where PHP listens to whatever event is thrown by a server, breakpoint reached, whatever. Next, if our IDE wants to instruct XDebug, which is running on your server, you can do that via the proxy. So you have to specify a host and a port. And there's an IDE key for meta information. I'm going through this very fast, but at the end, you'll see the blog post, and there it's all explained in great detail. So you can read back on that. Anyhow, if you go into the setup, you see the debug proxy, you see the IDE key, the host, and the port, and then you should be relatively good to go. That is, you have to instruct PHP Storm to register the IDE so that it knows who it's talking to. And then you have to start listening. This is this little telephone thing. I added my own button for registering the IDE because I thought that was convenient. But yeah. Okay, then that will be a very basic setup. You can use that in a local host. Nothing's difficult about that, but road warriors like you don't only work from home, you work from hotels, from airports, from any kind of position, and typically customers will wait for you to be in the most awkward position physically to come with a problem that needs to be solved now and then you'd like access that will be covered. Another aspect that's important for me and my company is that we wanted to have a collaboration where the debugging is not fixed to a single IP address, because that's the mode, the default mode, but that you can use it from many locations and allow multiple users. So the debugging anywhere, your airports, your home, there will be routers, firewalls, and all kinds of things that will make your life very difficult. For the collaboration, we will use a special proxy on the server to make it possible that more people connect, and the proxy will say, okay, this is coming from Eve, this is coming from Peter, this is coming from Victor, and route the information accordingly, but also more importantly, give the information back to the correct person. So not that Eve gets whatever Victor is requesting.
Yes.
So this will be the complete picture of the setup that I ended up configuring. And this is from our internal documentation, because truth be told, if I think of something like that, 3 weeks later I forgot about it. At least the details. I can reproduce it, but yeah, not really handy. So, a very important part of connecting this to that is using a secure shell. Who's familiar with SSH? Fair part. What do you use it for?
Everything.
Sorry?
Everything.
Everything. Yeah. I like your coffee recipe then, or the one with the brown sugar, or whatever, but... No, well, typically it's used to do remote commands. But yeah, the answer, everything isn't that far off because there's so much more that you can do with it. But different setups require different keys or passwords. So be sure to read up on how to set up a config file so that you don't only are limited to using your ID RSA key, but you can actually use different keys for different applications like GitHub or your production server, your staging server, etc. So let's first focus on this, where we want to connect our developer PC to our web server. We set up two tunnels, basically, one that connects the proxy to the proxy on the web server, and then the one that talks back from the web server to your debug port. Now you'll see different port numbers here. So 9001 is my debug proxy, and the default debug proxy on the server is also 9001. I listen on 9003, but the proxy talks back to me at 9005. Now, for those very observant, those might remember that when I showed command line interface, it showed IDE key 9005. That part is key to getting back from here to there, knowing that it's me. Because if I told it my IDE key is 9005, and then actually I have modified the version of this DB proxy, that then will be able to call me back on 9005. But that's necessary because I'm not directly connected to this server. I have to tunnel in through firewalls, through whatever something. If you were directly connected, you would have your own port, but you don't, so you have to tunnel that. If this is too fast, again, don't despair. That's all written up. Yeah, this is an example of a configuration file where you say, okay, I name a connection. I specify the user, specify the key, and I do lots of port forwarding. One for the MySQL database that's running on that other side. I want to access that, but it can't because it only connects on localhost. Now I can, using the port forwarding. For XDebugging, it's the same thing. So I forward port 9001 to 9001. That was the upper green thing. And remote, I forward port 9005 back to my local 9003. In this case, I also set up a mail catcher which I can address. So that's the 9005 setup here and routing back there. Okay, I want to leave it at that. It caused me some headaches. As I said again, it's a difficult topic to grasp. Once you grasp it, it's not that complicated, but yeah, find all the information there. I still have to add my slides and some things more, but that's going to take a picture of something. That will be it. And that should be able, in that way, you should be able to set up your debugging from any place, in any location. You might want to throw in an additional VPN connection if your remote server has a firewall that's limited to IP connections. So if you then proxy VPN through your local setup, then you're good to go. So on that note, I hope you never look back at Father and Die. I hope I've inspired you to start using XDebug or start using it more and using it to the full extent. And on that note, any questions? Yes?
Did you try at the time using XDebug in mixed application where you have part of the code that IMQ encoded or Zend encoded? And the part of the code is open source. In some recent PHP versions,
that IonQ encoded stuff specifically, but there is a mode where you can set up multiple connections so that it could actually listen to a front-end connection in parallel to a back-end connection. And that's just a setup in PHP Storm where you set the number of connections higher to one. But I personally don't have experience with that, but theoretically
my question is that, because when you try to use, for example, XDebug start trace function in mixed application with IonQ loader, it will just crash, right? It will set four.
Mm-hmm.
It will just crash, right? It worked in 5.4 and 5.5 PHP, right? But right now it's just that.
Okay, sorry, I wouldn't know about that. Right. I haven't encountered it, but yeah, stuff will evolve. I know that PHP 7 also had its challenges with XDebug, so yeah, it should go.